Hi guys, it's Charlie and welcome back to my YouTube channel. As a K-pop fan and a data scientist, I've been doing data analytics on K-pop. I'm trying to mine data-driven insights about K-pop industry. And if you watched my last videos, you know what I'm doing. But I'm kind of stuck in a bottleneck right now because I do not have enough data. So this time, I want to talk about my insights, my opinions about K-pop. I studied two different subjects overlapped together, K-pop and idol. K-pop is a music genre, idol is a type of entertainer. A K-pop singer like Psy, who sings Gangnam Style, is not necessarily an idol. An idol like Bogum Park is more an idol actor than a K-pop singer. I will further explain the difference in my next video about idol, but in this video, I'll focus on K-pop music and talk about my opinions after all these research. K-pop, the music genre, was created by Seotaeji and Boyz in 1992, and they mingled pop, hip-hop, R&B, and dance pop together with fashionable clothing and dynamic performance. It was a huge success as they brought the music that young people like to Korea and even made Korean government give up the censorship on music. As the policy no longer restricted the development of music industry, Seotaeji and Boyz have paved the way for the development of K-pop, although they just existed for 3 years. From 1992 to 1995, K-pop strode from 0 to 1. But in my opinion, the producer Lee Soo-man and his company, SM Entertainment, really made K-pop booming. I think the best way to understand K-pop is to follow SM's footprint, because they industrialized K-pop and has always been the powerhouse of this industry. In 1990s, Lee Soo-man was so touched by American boy bands and J-pop idols. He found that as television are going universal, people did not just buy CDs and listen to music, but began to watch music performance. It was important to produce visible music. Music should not merely be sung by good voices, but also be performed with good-looking singers, with trendy clothing, dynamic dance moves, and interesting music videos full of bright colors. Also in 1990s, Japan already had a very great music market and well-developed idol industry. J-pop idols under the total management by their agencies. Teenage idols are recruited and trained by those entertainment companies before they debut. After the debut, their songs, choreography, clothing, and makeups are all designed by companies. Their activities are all managed by companies. SM Entertainment brought visible music and total management together and invented a key concept, SM Music Performance, or SMP. This music performance consists of vocal and dance performance by good-looking idols, and they are not separable. Only listening to the music is not enough. You must listen and watch the music video or live show simultaneously to feel the charm of music performance. Because the music, the lyrics, the choreography, the clothing, the visuals, the stage design, and the music video are all designed together for a wholesome experience. Although this concept was introduced by SM Entertainment, it is also widely adopted by other agencies and K-pop idols. The emphasis of music performance is already a key characteristic of K-pop. This is also the reason why idols need to look great, sing well, dance well, and perform spectacular group dance.
But when you listen closely, you will discover something really strange.
Why are there so much code-switching between Korean and English in K-pop lyrics? English words are sprinkled around Korean lyrics. It is quite strange because you won't speak with so much code-switching in daily conversation. I think the main purpose of this is to make K-pop international. Maybe because SM Entertainment was inspired by American boy bands, They like to buy songs from Western composers and want them to go international. The songs sound just like pop music, with English lyrics in their demo. When SM's producers translate the English lyrics into Korean, the original catchy English phrases are remained, and they do sound cool. For example, let's listen to FX's Hot Summer and its English demo. In the way mentioned above, SM Entertainment produced the first K-pop idol group ever in 1996, H.O.T. And it was a huge success, not just domestically, but also internationally. Since then, SM and many other agencies began to produce other first-generation idols in a similar way as H.O.T. And also since then, K-pop is industrialized. Agencies are like star factories as they train their own trainees and debut the idols as brands. For the artists, they make comebacks, usually one time or more each year. Comebacks are like the products under this brand. A comeback consists of releasing the new album, the new music videos, new hit song, and even idols' new looks. Idols promote their comeback songs on music programs like Mnet, M-Countdown. On every episode of those music programs, there are multiple idols making their comeback promotions and compete for the first place according to sales and fans vote for free. I was shocked when I knew that music programs would not pay the idols. On the contrary, idols need to pay so much for their expensive stage designs and clothing for a comeback performance. K-pop stars also want to sell the song well, but the major purpose of their comebacks is to attract attention. Songs are like idols' ads, advertising themselves to fans and advertising agency. Yes, K-pop is very commercial. K-pop idols pay so much effort and money for promotion because they want to win first places. They release their expensive music videos and promotion videos free on YouTube for high view counts. Because how much first places and awards they win and how many view counts they get are key metrics that advertising agencies care. They also did the comebacks for acquisition of new fans and activation of old fans. In late 2000s, second generation K-pop idols entered the K-pop industry with brand new blood. They aggressively expanded their fandom to other Asian countries and achieved sweeping success. However, K-pop was not successful in Western countries. Especially, America has always been the largest music market in the world. K-pop also wanted to go west and get a share from this gigantic economic body. This is a clip of Wonder Girls performing in Toronto. The most successful K-pop girl group in 2008, Wonder Girls, also tried promoting their music in North America with English versions of their songs, but it was not successful. On the other hand, as Wonder Girls spent 2 years in US, they also lost their popularity in Korea. That was really an unfortunate loss. So why did K-pop not work there? I think one of the reasons was that in late 2000s, Americans were already bored of idol groups. While American idol groups inspired K-pop, American audience got bored of idol groups since they were manufactured in the same way. Americans like singer-songwriters with distinctive personality who sing their own unique music. As I watched Wonder Girls' music videos of their English songs, I just compared them with Western singers and felt weird because five girls perform in same clothing and even same hairstyle. I wonder why it needs five similar girls to sing one song if one singer could do that. But recently, K-pop became more and more successful in Western countries.
as BTS and Blackpink leading the third generation K-pop idols to the world. In my opinion, social media, Gangnam Style paved the way for K-pop's globalization. Gangnam Style let the whole world know K-pop and brought a lot of capital to this industry. Meanwhile, social media let the music performance spread across the world. During Wonder Girls era, smartphone was not even a thing. Now, smartphone and video platforms makes everybody be able to watch idols singing and dancing just on their hands. Especially, short video platforms like TikTok created a huge need for music that can dance to. I think this is the reason why VV Trend, Any Song Challenge, and now Permission to Dance Challenge can be so viral. Thanks to the fast development of social media and video platforms, K-pop has been focusing less on vocal but more on dance. I noticed that the choreography has generally become harder and harder, more and more powerful, and more sophisticated throughout K-pop's development. On the other hand, K-pop has been doing less and less singing. In 2000s and early 2010s,
band was also a popular form.
By band, I mean the idol group with only one main vocalist with other members playing instruments. But this form gradually faded away as the audience focus moves to the music performance than the music itself. People like watching beautiful dance moves more than pure singing. This also explains another trend, lip syncing. I remember that second generation K-pop idols did not have intense dance moves. Their choreography was designed to be smooth, so that K-pop idols could sing along with the dance. Therefore, they usually use live vocals or a mix of live vocals and pre-recorded vocals to sing. However, for the third generation K-pop idols, their dance moves become more and more intense. It is even hard to keep breathing with the dance, leaving alone the singing. They rarely use live vocals. Using the mix of live vocals and pre-recorded vocals is already a norm. Even lip syncing is not a taboo anymore. Today, fans are willing to accept lip syncing as long as the performers can dance well. Will K-pop's worldwide success last long? K-pop achieves worldwide success as BTS and Blackpink built global fanbases. These two groups' concepts are more adapted to worldwide audience than Korean audiences. They also did a number of collaborations with American singers like Lady Gaga, Nicki Minaj, Halsey, and Selena Gomez to promote in the Western world. However, BTS and Blackpink's success does not necessarily represent K-pop's global success, because we do not know whether this trend will last or not.
After 2022, BTS members will have to serve Korean military one after another.
Blackpink's contract will end in 2023. We do not know whether Blackpink will renew their contract and stay together. So, after 2 years, will the world still love K-pop? Or does the world just like the freshness of boy bands and girl groups?
Although Asian countries like Korea and Japan have a long history of idol music, proving that idol music are sustainable. However, in America and other Western countries, boy bands and girl groups trends can fade away when people get bored of these.
There is a fundamental difference between Western singers and K-pop idols' career development. Western singers hire managers to help manage their activities. Singers are their employers, while managers being the employees, because singers want to make the music they want. But for K-pop, agencies or entertainment companies hire idols and manage their activities in the way that company wants. Agencies are the employers, while idols being employees. It is quite normal for the K-pop idols to dislike their own music, but they still have to sing and dance to it for the group activity. We can say that this is merely cultural difference, but we can also say that this is putting the cart before the horse. Luckily, in recent days, self-producing groups also get great success, such as BTS, Seventeen, and G-IDLE. More and more idols talented in music production and choreography join this industry and smooth this cultural difference. Soyeon, the leader of G-IDLE, once pointed out that she suggested her company Cube to to stop vocal trainings for G-IDLE members so that they would not sing in the same way, but sing with their own charisma. I think this is a great sign of K-pop's development because members are getting more involved in their own music production so that they can persist their personality and unique characteristics. I also hope that in this way, K-pop, this global phenomenon, can be sustainable in future.